Hello, this is Anna Galletti, and this is going to be the very first video in our series of lectures for the Biology, Anatomy, and Physiology 1 lecture course. And if we go on to the next slide, you will see that what the topic is for this short video is part 1 and homeostasis, which is review for you from your previous biology class. But we're going to quickly go over it again, just to make sure we're all on the same page. All right, so briefly, let's distinguish anatomy and physiology from your other biology courses. So anatomy is going to be all about the structure of the body, and it could be any body. So it could be animals, it could be plants, but in this case, because it's our course, it's going to be human anatomy. Physiology is looking at the function of those structures within the body. Now, some places separate anatomy and physiology into separate courses. In our school, we have decided to merge them so that you have anatomy and physiology 1 and anatomy and physiology 2. And our philosophy behind that decision is that it's very difficult to study the structure without discussing the function. And it's very difficult to discuss the function without discussing the structure. These two are completely interrelated, okay? Which means they are complementary, or they have complementarity. Am I spelling that right? I am spelling that right, okay? So that basically means they are directly related. Okay? And you really can't talk about one without the, I mean, you can, but it's really hard to talk about one without talking about the other. All right, hopefully that wasn't too jarring as I put up that title. All right, so hierarchy of living organisms. This is directly from your basic biology course, and you need to know this. So we start at the chemical level, and then we go to cells, and then we go to tissues, organs, and systems. All right, and if you look back in the note slides, I've got the definitions of each of these. I'm not going to reread them for you because we've already done this in your previous biology courses, but you do need to know the different definitions for each one of these and how they are interrelated and lead to the other. All right, the next thing we're going to highlight that is reviewed from basic biology is homeostasis, okay? Actually, let's erase this and let's change the color to white. All right, so homeo right there means same, constant. Stasis means steady. So it's basically you keep a steady sameness within a very narrow range, okay? So basically, this idea is that you have a dynamic interactions of a lot of different things, but what they're trying to do is keep functions within a narrow range of variability. Okay, and there's a lot more to it, a lot more complexity that you'll study in Pathophysiology 1. If you remember from your basic biology course, we have three components that we're working with. And I'm just going to abbreviate them. We've got the receptor, the control center, and the effector. And then we have two types of feedback. You have positive and you have negative. Okay. Now, if we think about the mechanisms, we're going to start with negative feedback. And the reason we're starting with negative feedback is because it's the more common mechanism that we're going to be talking about in anatomy and physiology with the human body. Okay, so it is the most common. Okay, and it is also self-regulating, which means it turns itself on and off as needed to maintain homeostasis. Okay. One of our more common examples is to use the thermostat example. which is that regulator you use in your house to figure out if your house is too cold or too hot. So you basically, if we look at the example, we have a stimulus. So in this case, we're going to be talking about room temperature, okay? The temperature of the room will be picked up by a receptor, okay, or some kind of sensor of some sort, okay? So in this case, the actual thermostat itself. Now within the thermostat, there is a control center. The control center evaluates what information the sensor has picked up, the receptor has picked up. Is it too hot? Is it too cold? Then it makes a decision, okay? And it sends a command to an effector organ. So in our example, that would either be your AC, your swamp cooler, or your furnace, okay? And then the effector effects a response, okay? And then that is going to come back up here, and it's going to effect the stimulus so that eventually it basically, I don't know how to write this, turns off, okay? So once the temperature gets to the desired temperature, the receptor stops picking up the information, the stimulus to the control center goes away, and the furnace turns off or whatever. So basically it's going to negate the original signal. Okay. Now, positive feedback is different. And the key things to keep in mind here are, it's less common, so there are not necessarily less common, but fewer examples of this being used in the human. Okay, probably the only the two that I'm thinking of that are like on a daily basis potentially would be digestion and blood clotting. Those are both positive feedback mechanisms. One that's a little less common, but is the example that we usually use because it's very simple and easy to explain it, and that is child labor contractions. So if you have to remember one, try to remember that one as your example, okay? Now, it is not self-regulating. That is a very important idea. It has to be turned off by something else. Needs something else to turn it off, okay? And it is an escalation mechanism. Its idea is to make greater whatever is going on, whether it is to increase the number of clots you have or increase the number of contractions. Whereas with negative feedback, you're trying to negate it or get rid of the stimulus. With positive feedback, you're trying to increase the power of the stimulus. Okay, so the example would be when you go into labor, let's change color again. You've got the fetal brain and the placenta. And they are going to secrete oxytocin. The oxytocin crosses the placenta, goes into the maternal blood supply, and eventually gets to her brain, where it stimulates the release of oxytocin again. And then that oxytocin goes back to the baby. Which causes the baby to increase oxytocin. And then it goes back to the mother. And so basically you've got this cycle that is going to cause an escalation. And it just keeps going around and around. And then then the contractions of the uterus get stronger and closer together until the baby is delivered. And then you have other hormones that basically turn off this whole mechanism. once delivery is done. Basically, once the placenta is done. Okay. All right, that was it for part one. So the nice short beginning to all of this, and we will stop here and you can move on to part two of the videos.